In one form or another, the unusual way in which marsupials are born has been the subject of strange myths and legends for hundreds of years. The early navigators made many observations on kangaroos and wallabies as they explored the coast of the great Southland. Perhaps one of the earliest was the Dutch merchant Francisco Pelsart, who ran aground on the Abrolhos Islands off the coast of Western Australia in 1628. Despite the fact that his ship was wrecked and some of the crew had mutinied, Pelsart was sufficiently observant to record some interesting notes on the Tama wallabies which live on these remote islands.
Their manner of generation is exceedingly strange and highly worth observing. Below the belly, the female carries a pouch inside which are the teats, and we have found that the young ones grow up in this pouch. We have seen young in the pouch which were only the size of a bean, so that it seems certain that they grow there, out of the teats from which they draw their food. The young occupy the pouch until they are grown up and able to walk, and thereafter keep creeping into the pouch when they are hunted.
By suggesting that marsupial young grew from the teat, Pelsart and others created a myth which persists to the present day. The facts of birth in kangaroos and other marsupials were not finally known until scientific studies were made of all aspects of their reproduction. Most of these investigations have been carried out with red kangaroos in captivity, and this film has been compiled during these observations. In the wild, red kangaroos live and breed throughout most of inland Australia, where the annual rainfall is less than 20 inches. The red kangaroo is well adapted to these semi-arid conditions, and unlike most other marsupials, it breeds all through the year. This seems to be a very efficient form of adaptation to the environment, for if they had a regular breeding season, there could be frequent failures of whole generations of young because they were born at times unfavorable for their survival. The red kangaroo seems to avoid these catastrophes by having young enter the population at all times of the year. Those that leave the pouch at a time when they can find sufficient food and water survive. Those that do not perish. In the red kangaroo, only the males, like the one in the background, have the characteristic rusty red fur. The females in the foreground are usually blue-grey in colour, often referred to as blue flyers or blue does. In some areas, variations of colour can occur in either sex. As in many other mammals, female red kangaroos have a cyclic reproductive pattern. The unmated female has a period of oestrous, or sexual receptivity, every 35 days. The male is continuously fertile and will mate with a female whenever she is in oestrous. The male becomes aware of the approach of sexual receptivity and begins to follow the female. Such behavior may start two or more days before mating, and at times the chase may be energetic. He smells the pouch and the external genital opening, and quite often grasps the tail of the female. Once full sexual receptivity is attained, the female stands for the male and copulation occurs. This may last for up to 20 minutes. If mating is not observed, it may be diagnosed from the vaginal smear, a collection of cells from the vaginal tract of the female. The sample is then placed on a slide, and under the microscope, sperms can be seen in the vaginal smears of kangaroos which have recently mated. The reproductive organs of the female red kangaroo lie in the body cavity just behind the pouch and consist of two ovaries, two fallopian tubes, and two uteri. The two uteri open separately into the anterior vaginal sinus. The walls of this canal are thin and capable of great extension after mating as they become filled with seminal fluid. The two lateral vaginae are much narrower canals with thick muscular walls. The median vagina forms a direct connection between the anterior vaginal sinus and the urogenital sinus. It is down this median vagina that the young kangaroo passes at birth. If we section this drawing, we will be able to follow more easily the various stages of fertilization and pregnancy. After mating, the sperms pass up the two lateral vaginae, filling out the anterior vaginal sinus and moving up into the two uteri. The mature follicle, which has developed in one ovary, bursts just after oestrus and a single egg is shed. This egg is fertilized in the fallopian tube and moves down into the uterus. The follicle collapses and is replaced by a corpus luteum, an endocrine organ which produces the hormone of pregnancy, progesterone. Now the embryo starts the development, which will last for about 33 days. The embryo is surrounded by the yolk sac and a number of membranes. Throughout this period, there is no way of telling whether a female kangaroo is pregnant or not. This can only be diagnosed by opening up the animal and finding a developing embryo in one of the two uteri. However, the pregnant female is immediately distinguished from the non-pregnant one during the several hours just before birth. At this time, she begins an intensive period of pouch cleaning, putting her muzzle right into the pouch, licking the lining. She also licks around the opening of the pouch, but rarely the fur between the pouch and the urogenital opening. The female red kangaroo about to give birth takes up a normal grooming position. The back is usually supported and the tail passed forwards between the hind legs. Now the young has completed development and starts to leave the uterus. It goes down the median vagina, a short cut between the uterus and the urogenital sinus. Birth is preceded by the appearance of fluid from the ruptured yolk sac, and just before the young is born, the female vigorously licks the urogenital opening. If you watch carefully, you will be able to see one of the embryonic membranes, the allantoic sac, fall to the ground just as the animal moves. Now the young is born, enclosed in another embryonic membrane, the amnion, and quickly moves itself into a position where its head is towards the pouch opening. The young may be released from the amnion by the mother's licking or by the use of the sharp claws which are present on the front limbs at birth. During the early part of its climb to the pouch, the young is attached by the umbilical cord to the yolk sac. Eventually, this cord is broken, sometimes by the licking action of the female, and the young is attached only by its grip on the fur. The time taken for the young to reach the pouch is about 3 minutes, ranging from 1.5 minutes to about 4.5 minutes. During birth and the journey to the pouch, the young seems to be ignored by the female, who concentrates on licking blood and birth fluids from the fur. The female does not lick a track for the young to follow, but licks mainly behind the young, removing all traces of its passage. After the young has reached the pouch, the female remains in the birth position, licking the fur. Fluid will continue to ooze from the urogenital opening for up to 40 minutes after birth, and all of it is carefully licked up by the female. In the film we've just seen, it was difficult to observe the moment of birth because of the movement of the female as she continually licked the fur. So, to see this more closely, it is necessary to anaesthetize a female with Nembutal a few minutes before the young is born. This female is anaesthetized. Again, a few milliliters of fluid from the ruptured yolk sac appear just before birth. The young is born head first, enclosed in an embryonic membrane, the amnion. Once released from this membrane, the young starts to make its way over the fur to the pouch. The young, at birth and for some time after, is attached to the yolk sac by the umbilical cord. This cord stretches and eventually breaks as the young makes its way to the pouch. Sometimes the cord is broken by the licking of the female, but with this anaesthetized animal, the cord had to be broken artificially. The umbilical cord is attached to the yolk sac, which is still in the birth canal. The newborn red kangaroo, as with the newborn of other marsupials, is entirely without fur. It is blind and lacks even the development of organs giving a sense of balance. However, those centers of the brain concerned in the sense of smell are well developed, and the nostrils are open and large. During its climb to the pouch, only the front limbs are used, since the hind limbs, which become so large later in life, are mere buds at this stage. The fur below the pouch lies in such a way that the ends of the hairs point towards the midline, so that the young kangaroo crawls in the general direction of the ends of the hairs, over the fur rather than through it. Now the young has reached the edge of the pouch after its remarkable journey over the fur. Once inside, it will stay there for about 6 months before it starts to leave the pouch for short periods. As the young crawls down into the pouch, notice the lack of development in the hind limbs and that they are not being used for locomotion at all. On this female, the pouch is being held open so that the young can be filmed. With the pouch held open like this, it's unlikely that the young will attach to a teat because it seems to need the ventral wall of the pouch as support while drawing the teat into its circular and terminal mouth opening. Later, it finds and attaches itself to one of the four teats. Its tongue is large and muscular and capable of a suction pump-like action. This sucking stimulus on the teat causes the release of clear fluid on which the newborn young lives. As it grows, this fluid will become more like the usual milk of mammals. Once it has attached, the young maintains a strong grip on the teat, which forms a bulbous swelling inside the mouth. It is because of this that many people have been led to believe that the young kangaroo was born on the teat, presumably by some process of budding off. However, the young can be removed from the teat, provided that it is less than 1 day old. If it is any older than this, it will probably be unable to draw the teat into its mouth again. Newborn young removed from a teat can be placed on another teat in the same pouch. The sucking stimulus will cause the release of fluid from the new teat. The newborn young may also be removed from the pouch of one female and transferred to a teat in the pouch of another female. The clear fluid on which the newborn young is suckled is present 33 days after oestrus, whether the female has mated and become pregnant or not. Females which have never been mated will raise young transferred to their pouches, provided that the transfer takes place 33 days after oestrus. In most marsupials, the oestrus cycle is longer than the gestation period. In the red kangaroo, the oestrus cycle lasts for an average of 35 days, while the gestation period is 33 days. Pregnancy does not prevent a return to oestrus just after the young is born. However, the sucking stimulus of the newborn young terminates further oestrus cycling for as long as the young is suckled in the pouch. Because a female kangaroo returns to oestrus a few days after giving birth, mating and fertilisation can again take place. This postpartum mating is similar in many respects to the mating earlier in the film. This time, however, the developing follicle is in the left-hand ovary. The recently vacated and partly collapsed uterus is on the right. Again, sperms enter the uterus. The follicle bursts, shedding a single egg which is fertilised in the fallopian tube. The fertilized egg descends into the uterus but only develops to a blastocyst stage with little or no change in actual size. This is because the sucking stimulus of the young already in the pouch prevents the complete development of the embryo. This dormant blastocyst now remains in a partly developed state while the first young grows up in the pouch, usually about 200 days. As this first young grows, the composition of the milk gradually changes to become thick and white, quite different from the clear fluid on which the newborn young was fed. It is a remarkable feature of kangaroo reproduction that when two young of different ages are being fed at the same time, the mother is producing milk of two different compositions. In this pouch, the four-month-old young is feeding from a teat which has become greatly elongated. On the right is a second elongated teat on which the previous young, now out of the pouch, is feeding. Not until it's about 150 days old does the young first put its head out of the pouch. Soon afterwards, it begins to eat grass from a position in the pouch. By the time it's about 200 days old, it makes the first short journey from its mother. When the 200-day-old young starts to leave the pouch, the sucking stimulus is lessened and the blastocyst resumes development. This also happens if the young is lost prematurely. After about 31 days, the new embryo is ready to be born. The young out of the pouch still feeds from the elongated teat which it occupied throughout pouch life and which it now grasps from the outside. Under ideal circumstances, adult female red kangaroos produce one young every 8 months. Since each young is dependent on its mother until it's about 12 months old, females are frequently accompanied by a juvenile while suckling a young in the pouch. Although Francisco Pelsart's observations in 1628 were inaccurate, his interest in the details of marsupial reproduction is a tribute to his inquiring spirit.
Their manner of generation is exceedingly strange and highly worth observing. Below the belly, the female carries a pouch, inside which are the teats.
The facts of marsupial birth have been more accurately observed in recent years and are still highly worth observing. The production of a very small young, which climbs virtually unaided into the pouch and develops as an externalized fetus, is common to all marsupials. In red kangaroos, the offspring rarely fails to find the teat, and fertilisation immediately after birth ensures that the female has a reserve embryo should the first fail to complete pouch development. Although this mechanism is remarkably different from that in other mammals, it is highly efficient and seems well adapted to the environment in which these marsupials live.